Hi, I am Indu Motuncheri. I'm a PhD candidate at Rutgers, the State University of New Jersey. Today I'll be discussing about process modeling in pharmaceutical drug product manufacturing. So what is process modeling? One could say it is a concise mathematical description of an output quantity that is of utmost importance with respect to a deterministic input parameter plus a random component that describes the uncertainty such as process disturbance.
So an example to this would be a reactor where you have output parameters such as efficiency or yield or reactivity to be monitored with respect to input parameters like process conditions and flow and material properties, equipment design. So having a mathematical equation framework in order to represent this relationship is what process modeling is all about. So I'll talk about why it is important in pharma and how it has been done in pharma. But before moving on to that, I just introduce certain aspects of pharmaceutical drug products so that it is easier for me to use certain terminologies. So if you take an tablet, Advil, for example, you expect it to have ibuprofen, which is the therapeutic component. It's called active ingredient and to have 200 mg of active ingredient in it. But if you weigh the tablet, it weighs more than 200 mg of ibuprofen, or it weighs more than 200 mg. And the rest of the components are called inactive ingredients. And these inactive ingredients, as the name specifies, doesn't have any therapeutic effect, but it serves many other functions. Functions such as it binds the active ingredient together, or it keeps the integrity of the tablet intact. It makes sure that when you consume the tablet, it reaches the target position, it gets dissolved at that position. So when it comes to manufacturing tablets or any oral drug product, the integrity and the content uniformity of the tablet, which ensures that when you take a tablet, there is 200 mg of therapeutic component, is very important. Moving on to process modeling itself in pharma industry, there are many unit operations in pharma. I have only included oral dosage production here. I have not included the rest of pharmaceutical industry manufacturing because 80% of pharma industries is majorly, these are the manufacturing unit operations that are involved. So So if you start with mixing of all the components that I described before, like all the active and inactive ingredients, it goes through various operations. This is a concise flowchart. It has more unit operations, but generally there will be a mixing operation. And there sometimes is granulation operation, which is the area that my research is focused on. Granulation means increasing or improving the property of powder such that it could be easier to handle. So you add some binder into it and then increase the size of the powder or the content uniformity of the powder such that the tablet has the components that is desired. And then after granulation, there is compression, pre-compression, and sometimes they add sugar coating to improve the taste of the tablet. So there are many unit operations. So when it comes to process modeling, you can imagine all these boxes as one reactor, right? So you need to have a mathematical framework for describing each of these unit operations in order to understand the entire process completely. So why is it important, and why is the if you're familiar with pharmaceutical industries, there is a lot of buzzwords going around in pharma industry in terms of process modeling itself. It's mainly because FDA or other regulatory agents are pushing towards QBD approach. And what is QBD approach is quality by design. Pharma industry for long was was moving with the paradigm called QBT, and it's quality by testing. What it means is that you test the product and then determine the quality and then reject or accept the product. But this results in a lot of waste in terms of time, money, etc. So what QBD brings is sort of designing the formulation and the process itself such that the quality of the tablet or any oral dosage form is maintained. So in order to do that, in order to design the process, it's important to understand the process as well. And that's where process modeling comes in order to understand the process. Right now, because pharma industries are really, the regulatory agents are really stringent, like you cannot just use any process model. You need to get approvals from a lot of levels. Right now, it's used mainly to supplement the experimental studies and to sort of assess the design space and do feasibility analysis. It also helps in identifying critical process parameters, the parameters or the input parameters that impact your, for example, in terms of reactor, the yield. There are process parameters such as dissolution of the tablet that impacts the dissolution of the tablet the most. So identifying those critical parameters is also where process modeling comes in. But still, it's very underutilized in many industries. And the reason for this is all these process modeling in pharma industries, drug product pharma industries, involves around solid-based processes. It's interesting because as engineers, we are familiar with Navier-Stokes equation, which defines the fluid mechanics, right? But solid processes act like separate entities, discrete entities, and because of which the modeling of these solid-based systems are highly difficult, and it doesn't have that generic theory to describe how the process behaves. So I'll talk about some advances in terms of solid process modeling, where there are different modeling techniques to improve these processes or understanding of these processes. A main theory for discrete entities is discrete element method, and it uses Newton's theory, where if you know the force or if you conserve the force, you can understand what is the velocity and what is the position of each particle in a system. So that's how you deal with discrete entities. But what happens here is, in a system, in an actual system, there will be millions of particles. And if you have to work with millions of particles, if you have to work with millions of particles, it takes a lot of time. So this is an example for a discrete element simulation where you have two type of particles, the red colored one and the white colored one. And as soon as liquid is added into the system, you can see that the viscosity of each particle, whether they touch the liquid particles or not, based on that, the viscosity is changing. But the entire simulation is of 15 seconds and it takes weeks to months to simulate the system. But in actually the granulation or any mixing process in pharmaceutical industry will have like a time limit of 20 minutes or 10 minutes. So if you have to simulate the entire system, it will take up a lot of memory and a lot of time. So it's actually because of computational limitations, it's not that feasible to run DEM simulations. Coming to another modeling technique, which is very popular in solid-based systems, is population balance modeling. This is an area which my research is focusing on. So what it does is it sort of identifies a particle into different volume, like solid volume, liquid volume, and gas volume that is there in one particle. And it writes a population balance. But population balance means when two particle, example, one, when two particles come and contact with each other and form a larger particle, it assumes the volume is conserved and two particle is reduced into a single particle. So if you track this mechanism for a longer period, you tend to get an understanding how the volume or how the number of particle is changing, and you get the distribution of these particles with respect to time. And good thing about population balance modeling is you can specify what all mechanisms are happening. So for example, if you have a reactor and there is a reaction kinetics happening, you can write always a reaction kinetics equation, right? Like what is the rate of change of concentration in a reactor, and it is driven by the kinetics of the reactor. Same way in particles, you can always write what is the rate of change of increasing a particle size or decrease in a particle size, or what happens if there is a chemical reaction happening on the surface of the particle. So these mechanisms can be incorporated into population balance modeling using different physics or physical equations. So that is what my research is also focusing on. Another method that is widely used in solid process modeling is empirical, semi-empirical, or data-driven method as such. And the main reason where data-driven methods are used is to understand how material properties are affecting the process. So as you know, when you have multiple materials in a system, it's very difficult to predict the bulk behavior of the system. So people use tools such as PLS modeling in order to understand the behavior of particles and to cluster them into certain categories. For example, whether they compress faster or whether they won't compress faster. So that kind of information also helps in dealing with process design, and it helps with QBD, which I talked earlier. Another interesting research area that is happening even in my group is to understand residence time distribution in a equipment. So residence time distribution is very famous and is continuously used in reactor to understand reactor kinetics. So it sort of shows how mixing or how flow happens inside an equipment. In terms of particles, it's important because there are multiple particles that you're feeding into a vessel, right? And when there is a flow continuously happening inside the vessel, residence time distribution helps you to understand the mixing behavior that is happening in the vessel. So that is one area of modeling that is a lot of interest nowadays, especially because pharma industry is sort of moving towards continuous manufacturing, and RTD or residence time distribution models are of very importance. Then comes the last one, which is sort of putting all the models together and calling it hybrid model. So because, as I said, right, all models have its own advantages and disadvantages. The good thing about hybrid model is you sort of pick what all qualities you want and what all parameters you need to study from each model, and then sort of build a hybrid model such that you get efficient output out of the model. An example to this is a CFD modeling, where particles are modeled used in DEM, discrete element method, but then this is a fluid bed. So there is a fluid motion that is happening, and that motion is modeled using CFD. So when you couple CFD and DEM, you get sort of the entire kinetics in one box. So that's what you aim by hybrid models. There is another interesting study, which I'm not going in detail into, is sort of coupling DEM and PBM. So you get the velocity or the flow understanding from DEM, discrete element method, and you use it in PBM in order to understand the mechanisms in a better way with respect to flow. So those are hybrid models. Now, coming to my research area. So my research area is focused on high shear wet granulation, and I think this video I got from GLAT website, and it's pretty interesting because it shows you what is happening. So you have different size or different particles in the system, and when liquid is added to the system, these particles come together, stick, and form a larger granule or larger particle. We call it granule, and we are studying using the population balance model or all the modeling technique, the behavior of these granules. So that is the system of interest. And my research area is specifically focused on bi-component system. So far, the research was focused on single component system. Like if you have one component and if you add water, for example, how the size increases. But my research is more focused on two component system, where you have a difference in size, shape, or contact angle, which is very important when it comes to drug substances, because you have class 4 drug substances which are difficult to dissolve and are highly hydrophobic. So contact angle is a very important parameter when you study bicomponent system in pharmaceutical industry. So contact angle is what I'm also studying in my research. So you get these granules, right? So because of the difference in size, shape, or intrinsic parameters, you get granules of different properties. You get granules with some particles in it, some particles won't be present in certain granules. So what happens is that if you say make a tablet out of these granules, it is difficult to ensure the integrity or the content uniformity of those tablets. So when you have to analyze a problem, you need to first study the cause of occurring, why it is happening, right? So that is where my study comes in. What I'm studying is when you have two components, and when I do granulation, why is there, what is the reason that is causing this kind of disturbances in the granules form, and how can you model it efficiently such that it can predict these disturbances? So in order to understand the physics itself, few experiments were conducted with change in percentage composition of one component, and it was found that with change in percentage composition, the characteristics of the granule itself will vary. For example, there is a difference in how much percentage of one component is present in the granule, and there is difference in the size of the granule that is formed when you change just the percentage of one component. Now, I know what is happening, and I know that there is a problem that is occurring when you change the percentage composition, right? But how to build a predictive tool? So I looked into the initial stage of granulation where a liquid drop is just added onto the powder bed. So when you have a hydrophobic material, the particle sort of wraps around the liquid because of its hydrophobicity. And this substance that you see here is called liquid marble. And it is a very interesting formation that people have studied a lot because it acts like a liquid, but it is strong enough for you to hold using a tweezer. So this nuclei is something that I'm studying currently as part of my second part of my PhD. And by studying this nuclei, what I understood is that with changing the percentage composition of hydrophobicity, the behavior or the property of this nuclei or liquid marble changes. And if I'm able to measure these properties and sort of input these properties or the change in property into population balance model, then the population balance model will be able to predict the behavior that I showed before very efficiently. So in order to do that, I am using a data-driven approach where I am building random forest model and then sort of getting the probability of forming a certain kind of nuclei. I'm not going in depth into what kind of nuclei, but a certain kind of nuclei, and that probability difference in formation is helping my PBM in order to predict good results. So that is my research area. And yeah, so that's all I've prepared in terms of process modeling in pharma. Drug manufacturing, I'll talk a little bit about my career progress. I graduated NIT in 2012. I am like, as Vignesh said, I worked in ONGC for 4 years, and then I'm currently a fourth year student at Rutgers. I worked as an experiential intern at AbbVie for summer internship in the drug product development department. And then the next summer, I visited Hamburg Technical University of Hamburg in order to do some DEM simulation and to develop some softwares for them. And then with all the work I have currently carried out, I have written 2 papers, technical papers as first author, and two are under process. So that is my career progress so far. And the whole thing or the whole research of mine is possible because of my advisor, Dr. Rohit Ravachandran of Rutgers University. And these are my group members. They support a lot. And we have an amazing team at Rutgers and PSL group. And the content of this research is also taken from the research papers by Professor Marianti and Professor Fernando Muzio. They are a really distinguished professor in the field of pharmaceutical drug manufacturing. And yeah, that's it. Thank you. I'll take any questions if you